Thanks, everybody. The reason that we are here today is we're here to talk about a CDC study that just came out yesterday. And the study itself is rather straightforward. The heart of it is that the work that was done by the doctors and nurses and my staff here over the course of the last 4 or 5 months, I lose track of time, was not just extraordinary work on our analysis, but the CDC itself had said our work was extraordinary, but beyond effective. When I say beyond effective, the quotes that they have given about what has happened as a result of this reinforces everything we said from the beginning, which is that in spite of all the insanity going on, and in spite of, frankly, some of the reckless things that were being said in the media, we stuck with science. We stuck with science from day one. We stuck with science with testing, with isolating, with coming up with new places to house people, social distance people, mask people. We did all that. And as a result of that, as you can see from the chart behind me, whereas all around the jail, the number of positives was going up on a rather straight trajectory, we not only bent our curve, we killed off the curve. And I can tell you, as I stand here right now, a jail of just under 5,000 people now, we have 11 people who are positive, okay? 11. And of those 11, 8 or 9 of them came in positive from the outside. So the impactfulness of what was done here cannot be underestimated. Because right now, and the point I tried to make months ago, when these reckless, reckless people were talking about us being the hotspot, was that at that time, we were the only ones testing anyone. So of course we were gonna have the highest numbers. And what are we finding all throughout the country right now, as I stand here now, when they're finally getting around to testing, they're finding their entire facility is 100% infected. And we have, just here in this state, the Illinois Department of Corrections has tested 2% of their people. We have tested over just about 6,000 people to date of the 4,800 in here, 6,000 people. So what did we do? We stuck with science. And we tried to do this in a way that'd be thoughtful. And what the CDC has come out and said is that's exactly what it was. It was thoughtful and it was effective. And as a result of that, we are in containment now. We aren't in trying to bend the curve. We're in containment. And so as we go forward from here, our challenges aren't going to end. We have no delusions. This isn't a victory lap and mission accomplished. Quite the contrary. These other factors are still going to be out there. The virus is still out there. And as the virus is spreading throughout this country, that concerns us because we are not in a bubble here. I have employees who are just amazing, the work that they did here. Absolutely amazing, the work they did. But they have families. They have trips. All those different things that we're seeing throughout the country right now, and with young people who are going out and not wearing masks and then infecting older people, we're susceptible to that as well. So we will continue to test not just the detainees, we test employees. I brought mobile testing onto the grounds. We still do the screening, the temperatures. All those things will continue. But that is very concerning, one. The second thing that is very, very concerning to us is with the violence in the city, our population is going up. That's concerning to us because that makes it more difficult for social distancing. But let's not lose track of the fact. Right now, I'm sitting on about 450 people. So that's literally an entire building that aren't my people, that the Illinois Department of Corrections decided to just close their door. 3 or 4 months ago, with a 4-hour notice, they shut their door. In spite of the fact that our folks are all tested, our folks are all quarantined, our folks are not infected, they won't let those folks in. So does that cause us problems with social distancing? Oh God, yes, because we have an entire building and people aren't supposed to be here. The final thing is the length of stay. So the court system was shut down for 3 or 4 months, whatever it's been now, problem. But this isn't a new problem, folks. I have people that have been waiting on their trial for 11 years, 10 years, 9 years. You can't have that. That should never be in any situation. But certainly, when you're dealing like something like this, where you have to have space in correctional facilities, you cannot have these cases lingering for a decade, waiting for a trial. And that is what's happening. We have a list, we post it every day, of the length of time people have been in our custody. It's all on there, and it's not a pretty list. But those are the factors, all of which are beyond our control, that we're trying to work with my God, we're trying to work with them. But those are additional things that cause us angst every day. But at the end of the day, the study has shown what was started and what we've been doing and what we plan to do in the future is not only the way for this facility, but it's the way for all the facilities in the country. And this is a testament to the people working here for me, and it's particularly a testament to the doctors and nurses who, I can't tell you what they did. Amazing, just amazing people, phenomenal things they did. And on that note, I was going to have Connie Minella come here and talk a little bit. Connie, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sheriff Dart. My name is Dr. Connie Minella. I'm the Chair of Correctional Health. And thanks for the opportunity. You know, first and foremost, thanks to Sheriff Dart on this collaboration. This is an opportunity for me to thank others.
Can you come close to the mic, please?
Okay. How's that?
Yeah, that's much better.
Thanks for the opportunity also to thank others involved in our study and others that we've partnered with. I'd like to thank Dr. Stephanie Black from the Chicago Department of Public Health and Dr. Paige Armstrong from the CDC, both lead authors and partners in our complete response from the beginning. Of course, I want to thank Sheriff Dart and many of the line staff directly who worked, Sheriff Dart, I will give you a honorable doctorate degree after these 6 months here. We could not have done without the direct partnership with our colleagues at the Sheriff's Office. We do have some of the co-authors of the paper here that I'd like to present to you. Bridget Jones is our CIRMAP nurse epidemiologist. Our lead authors, Dr. Chad Zawitz, who's our lead physician for infectious diseases at the jail. Dr. Sharon Welbow, who is the director of infection control for our Cook County Health. Linda Camp is our chief operating officer. And Josh Brzezinski is our data analyst. We have other staff members, our lead nursing. Sheriff Dart, thank you for acknowledging our nurses. And here's our lead nurse managers over here. It's really important that our data analysts are here because so much of what we did rely not only on science, as Sheriff Dart mentioned, but on data and using data to inform our decisions and get control. I'm going to just read a little bit about our study and then we'll open up to questions. Of course, we could not have done any of this without having the resources of Cook County and Cook County Health. So I do want to thank President Preckwinkle and Dr. Claudia Fegan, who is our leadership at Cook County Health. Deb Carey is our Chief Operating Officer. And again, I thank all of them. Thank you for letting me thank them. This has been building for 6 months, having all of the support. Thank you. I stood before a podium about 4 months ago. We had not yet had COVID, and we knew it wasn't a matter of if COVID was going to come into the jail, but when COVID came into the jail. And here we can reflect on some of what we experienced. We're committed to doing everything we can to protect our patients, and we began this planning in January, as we've talked about over the months. We implemented many measures, many of the measures that Sheriff Dart already mentioned. I'm just going to go over them because it really was detailed in the paper, and this is a layering of measures, not just one measure, but so many measures, and we use science again to decide what to do. We expanded our footprint, which was one of our most important measures. That is a simple statement to say expanded our footprint. It was a huge, huge task. It required not only moving our patients across the entire jail compound that was no longer being used, but again, everyone from our facilities management partners in opening those buildings to our staff and literally creating a living unit and clinical space to take care of our patients. We masked all our staff and employees. We now know, as the world knows, that masking is so important. We did that very early on. We gave education to help everyone understand how important social distancing is. And none of this is new. This is all mirroring what the community was doing, what we knew worked in the community, and we knew we needed to mirror here. And we enhanced already existing very important annual our influenza program, where we knew in years past we had contained influenza. COVID is not influenza, but we knew that if we layered on top of that, we would have success. I think most importantly, as we tested, as the United States experienced the challenges with testing in the beginning, we also had those challenges, but once testing was available, as in the community, we began to test, and we tested to our best ability, and now we all know the importance of it. We believe our ability to contain the spread was due to this early availability of testing. We tested much earlier than other jails, and we were very fortunate to get rapid testing in mid-April, and that allowed us to inform housing decisions and patient care. The study outlines the early days of the virus within the jail, when the medical community, from the scientists to the epidemiologists, knew very little. Since then, our continued efforts, both strategies instituted in January and the other strategies that we all learned about, have contained it. We are not out of the woods, and we will remain vigilant. We understand that COVID still exists in the community, and as long as it exists in the community, it poses a threat to our environment. But we hope that we can help other congregate settings learn from what we did in the jail. We're providing testing now for symptomatic patients, asymptomatic patients, and we're conducting a significant amount of asymptomatic surveillance testing. We all know now that many people are asymptomatic, and that was very important to our containment. Every new detainee that comes in from the community is tested, not only at intake when they enter, but they are tested again while they are housed in separate housing, and they will not be sent into the general population until we get a second test. This has proven to be a very important part of our containment, and no other jail in the country that we know of is doing this type of testing. It's paying off. Our positivity rate for the last several weeks is less than 1%. This gives us comfort, and it also indicates the sustained containment. In fact, between this just this last week, from July 8th to July 14th, we tested 845 individuals for positive cases, and that's a positivity rate of 0.5% on a rolling 7-day period. During this same time, as Sheriff Dart already mentioned, there were 11 COVID positive patients in isolation on any given day, so very low rates. We staffed and supplied more than the dozen new areas to accommodate the social distancing. We're continuing to be very vigilant about masking. As in the community, there's mask fatigue. Everyone's tired of wearing masks all day. So we encourage our staff, we compliment our staff, and we appreciate both our staff and our detainees to keep each other safe. We must continue to wear masks. And it's the easiest defense we have right now. So we've done so much in these past several months, and we want others to learn from our experience to prevent the spread and contain the virus. Again, it's not a victory lap right now. This is serious. This disease is going to be with us in the community. As long as the virus is in the community, we'll be in the jail and other congregate settings. We always talk about, yes, we have brick walls, we have barbed wire, but we know that our jail is not impervious to this virus. I just thank everyone again for their vigilance. I thank everyone for the support, and we remain committed to caring for our patients and our staff. Thank you.
Connie, can you talk a little bit about to what degree movement is restricted still among the general population? And I can't remember, is visitation still not happening? Is there an update on that?
Connie can talk about the movement. Yeah. Visitation. I started visitation because of what everyone collectively did here. What most people don't appreciate is when people are locked up here, visits from someone is everything. I mean, they have no other contact other than the phone. We've been doing Skype-related ways for people to stay in contact as well, but it is huge. And so I was of the impression we had to move on that as soon as we reasonably medically could do it. And so what we did is the old Division 1 yard, which has not been used, Division 1's been shut down forever. That was a place that I thought, because it's so big, that we could have people so well spaced that we could pull it off. And so since June 2nd, I think it is, right about then, we've been doing visits. The first week it took us a while to ramp it up, and now we're averaging about 100 visits a day. My staff would be the first to tell you, it has had a remarkable impact on the mood of the entire jail. The detainees, stress, everything's been falling. That was what my goal was. It was just, I knew it would complicate things a tad, but because of all the work here, and, you know, Connie mentioned, you know, President Preckwinkle's office and facilities management, oh my God, the stuff they did was amazing. But because of all that work, we're the first jail in the country to reinstate visitation because we did all this work. So that's on visitation. On movement, Connie can talk about that.
So the same way we have collaborated to shelter in place, mirroring the community in shelter in place, we are now in the collaboration phase of how do we reopen. We have learned that some of the processes that took place during shelter in place, they're actually good and they're gonna stick. So we never had phone visits with our patients before, which is common in the community, right? So what did the community do in the medical field? They started calling their patients, so they had phone visitation, which much of medicine can actually be handled on the phone. So our nurses are doing a wonderful job, and they are talking with the patients on the tier. And we explain to our patient that the decrease in the movement is to protect them, because it's not like in the community where you can take responsibility for yourself, get yourself to A and B. Our patients have to go through doors and locks, and they just moving someone to one place is a lot of physical contact. So we are going to continue some of our shelter in place activity to deliver care. We're using our data analytics where we have trackers to monitor chronic disease and know when it's time for someone to have a face-to-face visit. We've resumed our face-to-face visits, not just urgent. We've never stopped seeing patients, never. Obviously, anyone who had an urgent health need or chronic conditions that require face-to-face, we never stopped that. We're continuing to do it cautiously, and we are cautiously reopening for all those non-urgent. But we're partnering because we don't want people sitting in waiting rooms. We don't want people to be large numbers in buses to go to Stroger for non-urgent. So we're in that phase right now and reopening some of our activities.